Hi guys, story recaps here. Today, I am going to explain a 2020 American monster adventure film called Love and Monsters. Spoilers ahead, enjoy the video and take care. The film opens with Joel Dawson narrating the present status of the planet. He claims that his life was ordinary, just like any of ours, until the end of the world. It all started when a massive asteroid, named Agatha 616, was on its way to Earth. Humanity banded together and launched numerous rockets to destroy the asteroid before it reached the Earth, and they were successful. The asteroid had vanished, the radioactive substance in the rockets fell back to Earth, causing all cold-blooded species to mutate. As a result, giant ants, roaches, crocodiles, lizards, and other large creatures now attack people. People were quickly killed by the beasts. Within a year, 95% of the human population had been wiped out. Those who survived took refuge in bunkers, caves, and panic rooms. Joel is one of the surviving people who has been living in such regions for the last 7 years. He and the other members dwell in a bunker. Joel says that the little space does not provide for privacy. About two of the members having sex right near him, while he pretends to sleep. Except for Joel, everyone in the bunker is in a relationship, according to Joel. Their first child was born last summer. Joel's daily activities include milking the cow and preparing food. Every month, they hold a hunting party, when certain members of the club go up and bring whatever food they can. Joel writes messages to Amy, his girlfriend, before moving into the bunkers. Joel is practicing hitting targets one day, when the lights in the bunker begin to flicker. Everyone begins to gather their weapons in preparation for an attack. There is a mutant animal in the area. Joel asks whether they need his assistance, but the gang orders him to stay in the bunker. Joel is a liability for them since he is unable to fight. The squad then departs to track down and kill the animal. Joel and a few other people remain at the bunker. They track the group with a gadget and discover that one of the team members has been killed by the monster. Joel grabs a crossbow and heads over to assist them. One animal has made its way into the bunker. Joel freezes when he sees it. Despite the fact that he has several opportunities to kill it, he remains still. When the others from behind him kill the beast, it is going to attack him. Return to the day the asteroid was destroyed 7 years ago. Joel and his girlfriend Amy are hanging out in their car. He sketches a portrait of Amy, and she presents him with a box of crayons as a gift. The city's emergency alarm goes off as they kiss. The missile pieces then re-enter the city, causing massive explosions. The two drive rapidly back home. After they returned home, everyone began collecting their valuables in preparation for a move to a secure location. They hug for the final time, split that day, and haven't seen each other since. She lives a few kilometers away in another colony. Joel still retains the box of colors he uses to sketch the monster creatures on his notebook 7 years later. Joel communicates with her over the radio that day. Joel's daily letters to Amy are discussed by the two. However, the call is cut off in the middle. Others on the team are sad about the loss of a team member. Suddenly, Joel inquires about Amy's colony. It turns out that it is only 85 miles distant. It will take 7 days to get there. Joel is really set on finding Amy this time. The squad members are taken aback since they know Joel is incapable of fighting. But he packs his things and leaves the bunker for the first time. He examines the map but finds nothing of interest on it. He doesn't even know which way is west. So Joel takes a risk and goes in an unplanned route. He walks for a time, thinking that the journey isn't as difficult as he anticipated. He meets various monster eggs along the route, but tries to remain optimistic. He picks up a frisbee off the ground and carries it with him. He then hears a noise close. Instead of attacking the creatures, the team members advised him to run and hide. As a result, Joel enters a nearby house. Curious, he opens the fridge and discovers a thing inside. He hurries back outside. He eventually ends up in front of a tiny pond. It has a tentacle protruding from it. Joel freezes, like he does when he feels afraid. Suddenly, a massive mutant frog emerges from the water. But Joel remains motionless. It uses its tongue to attack Joel, knocking him to the ground. Out of nowhere, a dog leaps on top of him. The frog snatches Joel's legs with its tongue and tugs him towards them just as he is ready to run. Joel is rescued by the dog, and they both escape to a nearby van. It appears to be the dog's house, Joel observes the word boy written on the ceiling and assumes it is the name of the dog. He spends the night in the vehicle with boy. He resumes his journey the next morning, drawing the dog on his notepad and thanks him for saving his life. Boy chases him while carrying his owner's dress. It's the only way boy can stay in touch with his master. Joel places the outfit in his bag and begins walking with boy. On their journey, the two become close friends. Boy keeps Joel safe from dangerous berries and other perils, while Joel tells him everything about his existence. Joel falls into a hole while walking one day. There are multiple tunnels inside the pit. The sand gobbler, a worm creature, emerges from one of the holes and attacks him. Suddenly, two survivors toss him a rope and drag him out of the hole. As he rises, he is attacked by a swarm of worm creatures. Clyde Dutton and his 8-year-old buddy, Minnow, are the only survivors. Minnow blows up an explosion in the pit, killing the remaining creatures. Joel and Boy follow the two strangers as they continue their search toward safety. It turns out that a monster murdered Minnow's father and Clyde's son, and they have been together ever since. The pair is now going north, where there are less monsters due to the colder environment and greater elevation. Joel chooses to stick with them till they must separate ways. Everyone comes to a halt as they come across a massive snail. Clyde forces Joel to remove his shirt and hand it over to the snail. His clothes smelled of sand gobblers, which drew the attention of other creatures. Now the snail will distribute it across the forest, confusing the monsters. The snail slowly moves away. Minnow tells Joel that some species, like the snail, are truly friendly. Their eyes reveal the story. They spend the following 2 days teaching Joel how to fire a crossbow correctly and other survival techniques. Joel sketches every monster they encounter. Finally, the day arrives when they must separate ways. Minnow insists on accompanying them to the north, but Joel has to find Amy first. As a parting gift, Clyde hands Joel a grenade. As Joel and Boy travel west, Boy becomes aware of a problem and disappears. Joel attempts to pull him out. But before he can, he is attacked by a massive centipede creature similar to the one he saw in the bunker. Joel gets to direct his crossbow at him this time, but then freezes. With its tail, the monster tosses him aside and surrounds Boy. Joel is lying on the dirt, remembering the day his parents died. He jumps up with determination and fires at the creature, killing him. He ultimately saves Boy, and the two of them celebrate. They spend the night at a motel, where they meet a talking robot named Mavis. The robot's battery only lasts 51 minutes. Joel asks whether she has a functional outlet where he can plug in his radio. Mavis hands him her last remaining battery. Joel ultimately gets in touch with Amy, who is concerned about him. She informs him that her colony would be leaving for a new location very shortly. They've discovered another group of survivors who intend to transport them somewhere secure. The power goes out before she can tell him where they're going. Joel takes Mavis outdoors and expresses his thoughts to her. Through its database, the robot gives him a photograph of his family. She is playing a tune for them when her battery dies unexpectedly. The next day, Boy and Joel continue their journey. They come upon a queen sand gobbler as they go. Clyde had told them that she was the most dangerous of all. The queen pursues them through the woods and attacks them. Joel and Boy take refuge by a river. Boy, on the other hand, becomes terrified and begins barking, revealing their position. The dress of Boy's owner falls into the river, forcing him to come out of hiding. The queen discovers their position, but Joel kills her with a grenade before she can attack them. Before the explosion, he falls into the water. When he comes out of the water, he discovers that many leeches had attached themselves to his body. He yells at Boy for revealing their location earlier. Boy, saddened, escapes from him. Joel is now walking alone, but the leeches appear to have poisoned him. He becomes dizzy and begins to hallucinate. Suddenly, a crowd appears in front of him. When he opens his eyes, he sees Amy standing in front of him. Amy is also startled to see him. The two kiss, but Joel soon falls unconscious. He finds himself in a bunker when he wakes. Amy greets him after discovering that he had kissed an old guy earlier. Amy has been at this colony since her parents died, caring for the aged people. She is the colony's leader since the elders rely on her. They have a beach house. Joel steps outdoors and takes in the breathtaking view. Several individuals are packing their things in preparation for their departure from the location. Another group of survivors had made their way to Amy's settlement. Cap, their commander, had promised to move them to a safer place, so they are now packing to leave. Cap produces his own beer, which is the party's main attraction. Later that day, Amy admits she is delighted to meet Joel, but has no love feelings for him. She has matured into a new person and is mourning the death of a close relative, implying that she was with someone else all these years before he died. Joel is heartbroken and apologizes to her for not inquiring before visiting her. Amy tells him that everything will be okay and asks him to join their colony. Joel, on the other hand, chooses to return to his colony and calls them by radio. His buddies also are happy and shocked to learn that he is still alive. They tell him that the bunker is no longer secure for them and that they would be leaving shortly. The phone cuts off in the middle of a conversation. Joel then discovers the fruit and beer that one of Cap's buddies had kept near him. He notices that the berries are toxic, as the kid had told him before. Joel thinks Cap and his team are plotting to poison the remaining survivors. He walks outside to inform Amy, but she is too inebriated to understand. Just then, someone smacks him in the head, knocking him out. Joel wakes up the next morning to find himself tied up on the beach. The others are in the same state. Cap confesses that he and his crew are pirates who invade colonies in search of food and fuel. He summons a crab monster outfitted with a rudimentary electric collar to eat the colonists. Amy and Joel are freed as the crab strikes them. She rushes to battle the crew, leaving Joel to deal with the monstrous crab. Amy gets into a fight with the crew's female member. Joel, to his surprise, manages to knock the crab over. However, Cap electrocutes the crab, causing it to hit Joel and knock him out. As Joel retreats, the crab walks towards him. Just then, Boy appears to help him. Dana is about to shoot Boy when Amy hits her, forcing her to kill the crab instead. Cap's crew runs to the boat and reboards their yacht. When Joel stares into the crab's eyes, he realizes that it is truly a kind animal. It had gone crazy after Cap electrocuted it. So Joel fires at the cable, electrocuting it and making the crab docile once more. It leaves the beach and heads to Cap's yacht to murder them all. Later that day, Joel packs his things to return to his colony and assist them. He offers Amy his book of monsters as a leaving present, and they kiss farewell. We see Joel make it back to the bunker with Boy after a 7-day journey. He eventually sees his old buddies. They, too, decide to seek refuge in the mountains. Joel urges more colonies to come to the surface through the radio. Finally, we witness several colonies migrating to the mountains in search of a better existence. Clyde and Minnow have already arrived, and Joel and Boy are on their way to the mountain, hoping to survive the next adventure. Subscribe and turn on the notifications. We daily upload videos like this.